You prisoners of New South Wales, who frequent watchhouses and jails, a story true to you I'll tell, 'tis of a poet's tour to hell. Our hero's valour had been tried on the highway before he died. At length, to death, he fell a prey. To him it proved a happy day. Downwards he bent his course, we're told, like me, destined to Satan's fold. And no refreshments would he take till he approached the Stygian lake. At length he then began to fix, contiguous to the river Styx. And thinking no one would molest him, he stood, when Charon, the gatekeeper, thus addressed him. Stranger, art thou friend or foe? What's thy name? Pray, let me know. Kind sir, I come from Sydney jail. My name I wish not to conceal. And as you do desire to know it, on earth I was called Frank the Poet. Are you that person? Charon said. I'll carry you to yonder side, and stranger, do not troubled be. I'll grant to you a passage free, though sixpence is my usual charge for passage in my well-pitched barge. But, noble guest, I'll have you know it, I never mean to charge a poet. No other sucker being nigh, Frank, with the invite, did comply, and leaving Charon at the ferry, went straightway down to Purgatory, and knocking boldly at the gate of Limbo, or the middle state, Pope Pius Nono soon appeared, with beads, gown, crucifix and beard, and gazing at the poet a while, addressed him in the following style. Stranger, art thou friend or foe? Thy business too, pray let me know, said Frank. For heaven, I am not fitted, so here I hope to be admitted, cried Pius. Vain are all your hopes. This place was made for priests and popes. This is a world of our own invention. So, Frank, I've not the least intention to admit you here, a foolish elf who scarcely knows how to bless himself? Frank answered, were you all insane when you composed this world of pain? For naught can I discern but fire, and share of that I don't desire, and midst it weeping, wailing, gnashing, with torments of the newest fashion? More justly they, the fools and elves, who made a rod to beat themselves. And may you and your honest neighbours enjoy the fruits of all your labours. Bidding the Pope a long farewell, Frank hurried to the gulf of hell. And having found that gloomy gate, he knocked aloud to know his fate. He louder knocked and louder still, till Satan came.
Pray, what's your will?
Alas, cried Frank, I've come to dwell with you and share your fate in hell, cried Satan.
That can't be, I'm sure, for I detest and hate the poor. None shall in my kingdom stand except the wealthy and the grand. So, Frank, I think you've gone astray. For convicts never come this way. They soar in heaven in droves and legion, a place so called in the upper regions. And Frank, I think with an empty purse you might go farther and fare worse.
Well, cried the poet, since 'tis so, one thing of you I'd wish to know. And I'm at present in no hurry. Have you one here called Captain Murray?
Yes, Murray's here within this place. Perhaps you'd like to see his face.
Oh, may God forbid that I should view him. aboard the Phoenix Hulk. I knew him. But who is that in yonder blaze? On fire and brimstone seems to graze.
Oh, he's Captain Logan of Moreton Bay. And Williams, killed the other day, was overseer at Gross's farm. And did you convicts no small harm? Cook, who discovered New South Wales, and he who first invented jails, are both tied to a fiery stake that stands in yonder burning lake. Hark! Hear you not that dreadful yelling? It comes from Dr. Wardell's dwelling. And yonder, see those fiery chairs? They're fitted up for beaks and mares, and men of all judicial orders, beaks, bankers, lawyers, and recorders.
Then Frank saw legions of traitors, hangmen, jailers, flagellators, commandants, constables and spies, informers, overseers, likewise. In flames of brimstone they were toiling, and lakes of sulphur round them boiling, hell resonant with hideous yelling. Alas, how dismal was their dwelling! Then Major Morrison, then he espied, with Captain Clooney by his side. They in fire belt were lashed together, as tight as sole to upper leather. Their situation here was horrid, for both were tyrants to the NORAD. Next he beheld old Sergeant Flood, in Vulcan's hottest forge he stood. He gazed on Frank, his eyes with ire, appeared like burning coals of fire. He, by a red-hot clasping band, was to a lofty lamppost chained, with fiery garments all arrayed, like wild Arabian ass he brayed. Loud he implored for Frank's assistance, to end for him his sad existence. "Cheer up," said Frank, "don't be dismayed. Remember number 3 stockade. In course of time, you may do well if you behave yourself in hell. Your heart on earth was fraught with malice. You oft drove convicts to the gallows. A greater rogue in shoes ne'er trod. You now atone for all that blood of convicts shed by Sergeant Flood." He next beheld that noted trapman and police runner, Israel Chapman. Steeped was he standing to his head in cauldron hot of boiling lead. "Alas!" he cried, "behold me, stranger! I've captured many a bold bush ranger, for which I am now suffering here. Oh, but lo! Now yonder snakes appear!" Then Frank beheld some loathly worms and snakes of varied shapes and forms, all entering at the mouth and ears to gnaw his guts for endless years. He next beheld the company's commissioner, at knee like humblest petitioner.
"Satan," he cried, "my life is ended. For many years I've superintended the agricultural company's affairs and punctually paid all arrears. But if you doubt the hopping colonel at Carrington, you'll find my journal. Carefully writ out in black and white, I'll prove that my accounts are right."
The poet turned to go away, but Lucifer begged he would stay.
"Now, Poet Frank, stay. Don't you go, man, till you see your friend, Dr. Bowman. See how he trembles, writhes and gnashes? He gave you many the thousand lashes. And for those same he does bewail, while Oscar with his iron fail thrashes him well, you may depend, and will, till time, shall have an end."
Just as he spoke,
A coach and four came up in post-haste to the door, and some 6 feet of mortal sin, sans leave or license, tumbled in. At its arrival, cheers were given that reached from hell to highest heaven, and all the denizens of hell with one rope pealed the greatest bell that ne'er was known to sound or ring since Judas sold our heavenly king. Drums were beating, flags were hoisting. Never before was there such rejoicing, dancing, singing, joy and mirth in heaven above and on earth. Straightway to Lucifer Frank went to learn what these rejoicings meant.
Of sense, cried Satan, I'm deprived since Governor Darling has arrived. Brimstone and fire, I've ordered him, and Vulcan has his tools to trim. And now I'll find a fixed abode for Colonel Wilson on the road. Don't go, Frank, till you see the novice, the Colonel from the police office.
Sir, answered Frank, I'm satisfied to learn that he's to be tied and tortured in this world of fire. With your leave, sir, I'll now retire. And after travelling many days over fiery hills and boiling seas, at length he found that happy place where all the woes of mortals cease. And rapping boldly at the wicket, says St. Peter,
where's your certificate? Or if you have got none to show, pray, who in heaven do you know?
Why, sir, I know Bold Jack Donahue, and Johnny Prog, and Jenkins too, and many more whom scourges bled, were lastly by Jack Ketch strung dead.
Peter, the son said, let Frank in, for he is truly purged from sin. Although in convict costume dressed, here shall he be a welcome guest. Enoch, go you with him to Job, and put on him a silken robe. St. Paul, go to the flock straightway, and kill a calf or two today. Tell Abraham, and likewise Abel, in haste to lay the banquet table, for we will make a grand repast, since Frank the poet has come at last. Soon Moses came, likewise Elias, John the Baptist and his pal, Matthias, with many saints from foreign lands, and with the poet all shook hands. Through heaven's concave curfew rang, and hymns of praise they loudly sang, and while they glorified their theme, I woke and found it was but a dream.